Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Welcome, everyone. It's Monday night. What a great way to start off your week for spiritual nourishment and empowerment by coming to Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. You can find me here sitting in this captain's chair conducting all the affairs of heart. I appreciate you being here. We'll give you a couple of quick adverts right off the top because I'm about empowerment. I'm about giving. I'm about spreading the light. Let's see. Let me pull up this folder here that has all the information. April 29th, Battle of the Bands, Mid-South. If you live in the Mid-South area, the question is, are you ready for Battle of the Bands? Saturday, April 29th, from 12 noon to 5 p.m. at Joe's Thirsty Lizard, Horn Lake, Mississippi, 6541 Highway 51. Let me name you the bands that's going to be there. And this is all for the raising money to go to the Make-A-Wish Foundation. 100% of the proceeds goes to that phenomenal cause. And here are some of the bands that are going to be playing. That's one thing about Memphis musicians. They love supporting the community in a situation when something arises. That's one thing I love about this city. Jack Rao and the Royal Blues Band, Andrew Kabigao and Accidental Field Trip, Adam McClellan and the Hangover, the Medallions, Five Cent Out, Where's Mona, Prayer Warriors Band, Midnight Train from Memphis. There's going to be a $1,000 door prize for the top band, so forth and so on. April 29th is the date from 12 noon to 5 p.m. at Joe's Thirsty Lizard in Horn Lake, Mississippi. If you're in the area, stop by. Give your support, give some money for a phenomenal cause. These kids can sure use it. I've been a part of this program, the Make-A-Wish Foundation, often on many different ways for many years. Also, I have another fundraiser, the Kenneth Pass fundraiser. Kenneth Pass was a guest I had on Center of Light Radio some time back. Kenneth Pass was a child on a summer camping trip with some friends, as well as some teachers, chaperones, whatever you call those people, the guides. They went on a hiking trip, and somewhere about 10 miles into the journey, they were abducted, and they were brought back 10,000 years. Now, Kenneth hung out, for lack of a better word, with these alien beings, these extraterrestrials, for 2 years, moving and about through different timelines. And one of the aliens pissed him off. And so he decided he's going to take some of this technology and hide it. And he hid it somewhere in Arizona. And Kenneth feels like this is something that has to be done. He needs to make his way back to Arizona to retrieve this alien technology that he buried. And he needs to bring it to the Hopi and the Pueblo Indians. And I believe Kenneth's story. I do. Kenneth is a very simple guy. Just a very country Tennessee boy. He doesn't have the funds that a lot of us have, and he wants to make his journey to Arizona. And I'm thinking a bus trip, and I did speak to Kenneth. The bus trip would be fine. It's about $300, give or take. I'm sure we can do that with the size listening audience Center of Light Radio has. I donated some money. I have a couple other people donated some money, and I'm thinking $500 should do it total, so he can have his bus fare to and fro, as well as some money to have a little bit of fun on it, as well as have something to eat and water and everything else he might need. But the gig is once he returns with his experience intact, he's going to come back on Center of Light Radio and tell us how all that went down. We should make a part two of the Kenneth Pass story. I have a fantastic show for you. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that here shortly. We're waiting on my guest, a powerful guest. We're going to be talking about dreams. Since I've been with Inception Radio Network, I have never done a show about dreaming. Shame on me. Well, tonight I have the master of it. I'm going to get to her bio in a little bit. Let me tell you about some services I do. In fact, tonight would be a great, phenomenal night to call in. I haven't asked my guest yet for permission if someone can call in, but I know her quite well and I know her spirit. She would probably say, oh, please open the floodgates and let them call in. Tonight would be a fantastic night to call into Center of Light Radio to ask my guest about a dream that you've been trying to decode for a long time. And the number you do to call in is 888-919-2355, 888-919-2355. I provide many, many services. I've been doing speaking engagements for many, many years, life-changing presentations on spirituality, divine incarnations, extraterrestrials, as well as my own personal experience with extraterrestrials throughout my entire life. I can cater to whatever theme you want me to speak about for whatever it is you want me to present. And you want to be a presenter in your hometown? I live around the Mid-South area, and I'm available. So look into that. You can always find me at KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com if you want me to do any speaking engagements for you. And there are many other themes that I can be speaking about, believe me. So just let me know what it is you might be interested in. Spiritual readings or life coaching. I don't do it from a perspective of being the psychic, because sometimes that can really go psycho. That is not my deal. That is not my gig. Though there is intuitive work involved, and I may tap you in the knee and give you a piece of, quote, psychic information, but I do not go about it from the perspective as if I have a crystal ball. I'm just not going to do that. But what I will do is empower you with some insight. I will give you the insight and let you know what I am getting at any particular level about any particular thing to let you know that this is a potential of something that can happen in your life. Now, it's to me, the vibrational tone doesn't seem too really, really cool. It's not something I don't think you're really wanting. So what you can do is get clear about it from this perspective and do this and don't do that kinds of thing. Or if there's something you want in your life, who am I to tell you what you deserve and what you are able to create other than to share with you what I might be picking up that might be powerful and potential for you, and to help you achieve that, which is beyond my own understanding, because no one knows better about your life than you. So that's the way I do that kind of thing. See what I'm saying? And also, if you have any dark entities in your house, ghost squatters, spiritual squatters, shadow people, these little boogers can get pretty mean. Let me tell you, they can bite, they can scratch, and I come with an arsenal of information. Tons of information, pictures, certain holy pictures, certain mantras, sacred mantras, many, many different ways to help lift your vibration so that these beings will not be able to see you anymore. And I promise you, and I will not leave you unless the gig is completely done. I won't just hand you the information and just take off. I will be in it with you all the way, because I know the trouble that sometimes these entities, energies can be in a family household who is just wanting peace and love with the family unit. So again, I will be with you all the way until they have checked out of your house and your house returns to the happy home that you desire and deserve. And again, for any of these services, you can reach me at KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Still waiting to hear from Nucleus 8, my alien human hybrid friend. Been talking about Nucleus 8 for, in fact, everyone, in about, 3 days is going to make my third year anniversary with Inception Radio Network. And I want to send a big shout out to Joe, my producer, Bob, MJ. A phenomenal team. They have accepted me warmly. They put up with me. And Joe and I have just some of the most amazing chats in the green room before and after the each Center of Light broadcast, which is really, really cool. But it's going to make my third year. And I think about now, and I'm proud to say that my listening audience should be give or take right about 3 million. Now, keep in mind that includes live listens, downloads, as well as archive hits. So I've been talking about Nucleus 8 for quite a while, and you're like, okay, Keith, bring this guy, I want to hear about him. Well, because he's head of security for this quadrant of our galaxy, it's not like I can just call and say, hey, brother, are you available Monday night at 6 o'clock, and he shows up. It doesn't quite work that way, but he will come around, you can bet. Still waiting to hear from Swamji Viswayogi, God-realized man from India. I've interviewed Swamji twice in my life. What a powerhouse of a divine man he is. He's supposed to be coming back to Memphis sometime really, really soon. Speaking of another cosmic individual, and when you're standing in the presence of a holy man like Swamji or anyone who is God-realized or at least to some degree seriously illumined, you will feel it. It's not something to be said. It's something to be felt. Trust me, it is very, very, very powerful. In the very near future, I'm going to be doing some speaking engagements all around the country. We're going to start off here in the Mid-South. You can go to Center of Light Radio real soon. You're going to hear it here first on this show. I'm going to announce that I'm going to be doing some traveling about and doing my presentation, which is Live Your God Fire. This is going to be Sunday services likely at Unity Church's Live Your God Fire. But I'm also going to be doing some workshops called Radical Transformation, Pressing Reset. How to get into a state of absolute awareness to advance yourself spiritually. It does not necessarily have to be difficult. I promise you, I can hand you a couple of quick tools. It's not a cure-all, and it's not a fix-all. It's just a way you can buy you some time so you can do the intensive work that you need so you can begin to beat your feet towards your absolute bliss. I have my guest on the line. Let me read you a bio. Kelly Sullivan Walden is on a mission, she says, to awaken the world to the power of dreams. Known as America's premier dream expert, she is number one best-selling author of I Had the Strangest Dream, and It's All in Your Dreams, Chicken Soup for the Soul, Dreams and Premonitions, and the newly released Love, Sex, and Relationship Dream Dictionary. She is also a certified clinical hypnotherapist, inspirational speaker, and founder of Dream Life Coach Training. Kelly has reached millions of people with her inspiring message on national talk shows such as Dr. Oz, Ricki Lake, The Real, Bethenny, Huffington Post Live, Coast to Coast, and Fox News. Kelly, welcome to Center of Light Radio, darling. Hello.
Hi, it's so great to be with you, Keith. Sorry about the Mercury retrogradient stuff going on, but
thank you for making the excuse for it all, because I was having a tough time myself.
Good old Mercury retrograde. It's always a nice excuse. No, I'm so sorry. Thank you.
Let's just blame it on that Mercury retrograde. How are you, darling?
I am great. I'm great. I'm thinking about the Margaritaville song. It's like some people say there's a woman to blame. Well, it's Mercury retrograde's fault. So it's all my fault.
Busy lady, ain't you?
I've been busy. I've been a little crazy lately, but in a good way. Yeah. Life is good. Life is in session.
I would lean more on the crazy side than normal for me as far as my life goes. To me, normal's crazy. Now crazy's normal.
I love the saying, if you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much room. That's my motto.
What have you been doing as of late? I mean, I'm seeing you pop up all over with these talk shows and getting yourself out into the field in a big way and capturing the attention of large audiences all at once in one session. That's pretty phenomenal work, girl.
Well, thank you. I just follow the breadcrumbs through the dream forest and go where I'm asked to go. I just recently got back from Mexico co-facilitating a Dreaming Heaven workshop. There's one of the books that I wrote with Lee McCormick, Jenny Gentry, and Frank Hayhurst. It's called Dreaming Heaven, and it's based on the Toltec dreaming philosophy and initiation, and kind of a way to bring an ancient tradition for modern folks that want to wake up. So that was awesome. And if people want to have their own Dreaming Heaven experience, we kind of put it all in a workbook and in the book, but we got to take it to the pyramids of Teotihuacan, and that was amazing. And, I've got other workshops coming up. I've got some stuff coming up on the East Coast at the end of May, beginning of June. And I'm going to be speaking at the International Association for the Study of Dreams in June as well. For anybody who likes dream conferences, this is like the big international conference that happens every year. And it's going to be in Anaheim, California, which is kind of local for me. Usually it's in another country, so it's nice to not have to travel too far. But just got myself busy following the breadcrumbs through the dreamy forest. How about you? What's the latest and greatest with you?
Like you, but differently. My life is full. I play music all the time, be it with my rock band, which is always a hoot, but also solo acoustic all around the city, restaurants and taverns that are a little lower key in nature as far as volume and intensity. Finding awesome, powerful, enlightening guests like you for Center of Light Radio. And during the week, I do a once-a-week broadcast for Burst of Light live feed videos, which are taking off. I find these themes and I ask people what they want to know more about, and they collect in the room, and I do a Burst of Light live broadcast. And it's a new love of mine, a brand new passion of mine. I'm digging it. In fact, here you go. This week is going to be about dreams, out-of-body, sleep paralysis, and lucid experiences.
You're right up my alley.
So did you have a dream? Was it a dream of yours to be an expert in dreams? How did you get all into this? I mean, did you just have this far-out experience one night and go, oh, my God, I got to know more about this stuff, and therefore later down the road, you're a dream expert? How did that work for you, darling?
No, it was Well, it started with it just being this normal phenomenon that was fun for my sister and I. I have three sisters. The sister closest to me in age, Shannon, she and I always would have tandem dreams where we would show up in each other's dreams. We would talk about a dream and the other person would say, "Oh my God, I know exactly who you're talking about." So we shared similar characters, similar dreamscapes. And because of that, both of us paid particular attention to our dreams. And that became a regular conversation piece for both of us. And because of that, I think everybody as a kid pays attention to dreams, but they don't always have somebody to share the dreams with that doesn't think they're crazy. So I had that. And growing up, my dreams helped me navigate relationships, get through issues with school and difficult times. And to have, I would sometimes, if I was having a difficult time with a friend or something in school, I would have a dream where I got to see what was going on in their home or see what was happening that my ego wouldn't be able to see. And I'd be able to have some compassion and not take things so personally. So my dreams just were deeply healing for me. And then in my 20s, I went off to Hollywood to pursue acting, and that was fun and great and all. And I had some fun parts. I got to work with Clint Eastwood and Nicolas Cage and
dig that.
Forrest Whitaker, and had some fun times. And at the same time, it was incredibly, it's hard on me because I kind of gave up what was internal and was more focused on all that could bling and be all the stuff of the outer world, all of the stuff of Hollywood. And at some point I felt like I totally lost myself. Like I had lost my soul somehow. I wasn't focused on what was going on in my dreams and my soul anymore. And I hit a crisis point where I literally didn't want to be on the planet anymore because I felt like I couldn't find myself. I was gone. And I saw a therapist, and she told me, because all I could remember about my dreams were nightmares. And she said, "A nightmare is an unfinished dream." And that was a pivotal moment for me, that saying, "A nightmare is an unfinished dream." And that led me to think that it's not just the nighttime dreams that we have, but our waking lives. If we're having a nightmare of an experience, it's not finished. It's somewhere in the middle, and we can change that. So it's up to us to make that change. And that's what I kind of started dedicating my life to.
How are you coming up with your assessments, your analysis when you're done with it? If you're working with the client, did you go to school for that? Do you use your own life experiences to be able to balance what these interpretations, these dreams could mean?
Yeah, I blend a bunch of different systems together. I've studied human design. I've studied Carl Jung. I've studied with some shamans. I've all kinds of different ways and techniques and modalities. But at the end of the day, when somebody shares a dream with me, I let go of all of that. I let go of my thoughts, and I just do my best to become as blank and as open as possible and allow allow myself to step inside their dream with them as much as it's humanly possible to do. And I feel the energy of the dream. And even if it's a bad dream, I don't care, because I feel like it's an honor to get to feel what somebody else feels. And I know that it'll pass through me. It's not going to stay with me. And from that perspective, I get a hunch about what the dream is trying to help the person do. I feel like in a nutshell, our dreams are always helping us to either let go of baggage that's holding us back, or it's helping to propel us forward towards the light of who we really are and who we're capable of being if we were to wake up. So it's one of those two things usually that I can feel is the strongest theme that the dream is. And then I offer my insight based on that. But I do, before I say a peep about what I think the dream means, I ask the dreamer a series of questions. Like, if your dream were a movie, what would the title of the movie be? What would the subtitle be? And what's the primary energy? And what do you most want to know about this dream? And how does this dream feel or make you, what does it make you think about that might relate to your waking life? Something that just happened to you or something that's unresolved in your life. And And usually people begin to answer the questions. And if I let people talk long enough, usually they say some pretty revealing things about what their dream was telling them. And then I kind of come in at the end of that and offer my insight and affirmation, never trying to take the power away from the dreamer, but just giving them back their power and shining a light on some of the themes that they've said and some of the themes that resonate with me and my body about what I think their dream is trying to help them do.
I love it. I love that it's not so methodical and that it's all inclusive, that you can take a piece of knowledge that you learn from this and from that. And that, like I said before you came on the air, when I do spiritual readings, I don't like playing the psycho or the psychic card. Because right. I will give you insight. There will be insight or intuition or psychic reading involved, but I don't want you to hear what I'm saying. I am only there as a sounding board, as a guide for you to pull out your best. If I see something potentially that you can't see, that is something you don't want to manifest in your life, I'm not going to tell you what I think that is. I'm going to say this energy over here feels like it's blocked, and I just want you to be aware that da-da-da-da. And same thing on the flip with their positive stuff, because I may give you a vision that you're going to win $1,000, right? And what I did is I just pigeonholed that person from winning $2.5 million. And so that's very dangerous ground for me. And I like that the fact that you left the power in their lap so they can choose.
Yeah.
Because your interpretation basically helps them to see or understand what they couldn't, like when you left it up to them to tell you the secrets, they basically verbalized, they just needed you there as a sounding board so they can hear their own guidance.
Right. And I feel like I'm, you know, there's a lot of dream analysts that are very purists where they won't say a peep about what they think or what they feel. And I'm not exactly like that, because I will weigh in what I'm feeling, but it's after they get what they think out of the way. And some people will say, I don't know. I have no idea. I think my dream means I'm crazy, or I think there's something really wrong with me. And if that's where they're going and that's the best they can do, then I'll chime in and say, if it were my dream, I would think that, you know, for example, somebody just shared a dream that she has a series, a lot of really light people. And I'm sure a lot of the people that are drawn to Inception Radio, Center of Light, are light chasers and are really, you know, focusing on wanting to grow their light. Just like the woman that I just recently had a conversation with, and she was talking about how troubled she is about these incredibly violent dreams that she has, where she's the one that's beating people up. And she's like, she was so ashamed in telling me this, because she's this lovely, kind, warm, gentle sweetheart. You would never in a million years guess that she has a lot of dreams about beating people to a pulp. And she's like, what does this mean about me? And just, I think I'm crazy. Oh my God, there's something wrong with me. I can't tell anybody.
Would that be aspects of herself that she's beating up? She's beating up herself in different ways.
Yeah. Well, you're very intuitive, of course. So yeah. So my perspective is, if it were my dream, my perspective, first of all, and I borrow this from the late great father of psychotherapy, Carl Jung, he said that everyone and everything in your dream is you. And I believe that it's true in dreams, and it's also true in life. We're all of it. We're connected to all of it. So I told her, I think everyone in the dream if it was my dream, everyone in the dream is me. And it's like you're doing battle with the part of yourself that you are wanting to change or wanting to release any negative patterns with.
Question here, and I kind of got an idea what I think you're going to answer, but I'm curious. Well, actually, I'm looking forward to hearing you put this together. Is there a relationship between the dreams we have at night when we sleep and the dreams we have as visions and aspirations for our future to do what we love?
Oh, I absolutely think that that's true, for sure. I mean, you know, there's the perspective that, you know, I refer to Einstein when it comes to this kind of stuff. And he said it's that, you know, everything in the universe is working on behalf of your greatest good. The most important question you can ever ask is this universe friendly? And his conclusion is yes. And it's all moving us towards something. So whether it be the dreams that we have at night or visions that we have in the day, or even the things that we would consider as desires or those things that really light us up and make us happy, that we want to manifest, All of those things are part of the same trajectory, I believe. And we get these little kernels of light and wisdom as we that light our path, let us know that we're on track. So it really doesn't matter where the insight comes from, as long as we can recognize it when it comes and we can allow ourselves to be affirmed by it and to take it and be. I always think that our job is to become the most excellent dance partner we can be with the universe. We let the universe lead, it knows, and we just follow. And we can obviously chime in about what we think and what we like and all that jazz, but the universe is on our side and it's helping us to glom on to these visions. And I think our dreams, though, our nighttime dreams, what's cool about those is that often they reveal what we can't see in our normal waking life. They
is it
reveal
because we're vulnerable? Is it because we're more vulnerable? Because the reason we are able to stay in our bodies in waking states of consciousness is because we are bodily aware. But during sleep, we lose that very awareness of the body that we need to stay in it. Is it because we are vulnerable that we're able to receive those little tidbits that we cannot when we are awake?
I think the word vulnerable, that's a very interesting perspective. I like that. I use the term that we've got, our walls are thin at night.
Okay.
And partly, and even from a neurological perspective, when we go to sleep at night, our prefrontal cortex, that's the part of our brain that does our rational, logical thinking, it's exhausted. It goes to sleep. It shuts off. It's out like a light. But what wakes up when we fall asleep is our limbic system and is our emotional, it's our emotions, everything that's been suppressed. It's the part of us that is, our visual cortex wakes up and runs the show. So it's the part of our brain that thinks non-linearly, the part of us that is emotional, the part of us that is creative. So in a way, our logic is wonderful. We need it in our waking lives. Without it, we would just be stumbling around and bumping into each other all day. We would never be able to have a conversation or get anywhere. But it also blocks us. It also edits some of the wild, crazy, amazing insights that the rest of our mind is capable of. And at night, we have no choice but to indulge in that part of us that our waking mind thinks is crazy. That's why my first book is called I Had the Strangest Dream, The Dreamer's Dictionary for the 21st Century. But most people wake up from a remembered dream and they say, I had the strangest dream. And it's only strange to the logical prefrontal cortex part of the mind. It's not strange to the emotional part of the mind. It's not strange to the association cortex in our mind that draws these conclusions in a very creative way. But when we evaluate it from our logic, we go, oh my God, that's so strange. But when we're in it, it makes perfect sense. Doesn't that make sense?
Absolutely. Keith Anthony Blanchard here, your host of Center of Light Radio, Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. You can find me sitting in this chair. My guest tonight is Kelly Sullivan Walden, and we're speaking about dreams, everything dreams. Kelly, would you give out your contact information to our listening audience so they can find out more about you and keep up with you and all the amazing things you're doing, empowering people to tap into deeper parts of themselves and their dreams?
Thank you. Yeah, they can go to my website, which is the hub of everything, and they can get there by going to ihadthestrangestdream.com. ihadthestrangestdream.com. And that's also my name, KellySullivanWalden.com. Both of those URLs will lead to the same place. Facebook is Kelly Sullivan Walden Doctor Dream. It's not Dr. DR period. It's Doctor spelled all the way out. Facebook, that's Facebook, and then Twitter and Instagram is Kelly S. Walden. And I have a brand new Facebook page that we literally are just now getting ready to launch. Right now it's called Lipstick Mystics, but it's going to be called Spiritual Girls in a Material World. And it's a podcast that my friend and I, Nancy Telzero, and I are doing, where we blend spirituality with all the things that also bling in this world and the things that spiritual girls living in a material world should know about. And also it includes things that men would like too. So that's something that you can look for on Facebook.
Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. I have a question for you. What about loved ones who show up in dreams? Are we actually having any experience, or are we not? Or how can we tell the difference if we are being visited or not?
So you're talking about a departed loved one.
Departed loved one,
the
yes.
Other side. Okay. Yeah, that's a great question. And it's the source of deep, deep healing and deep fascination. I have heard so many, I've heard so many of these dreams because of the Chicken Soup for the Soul book that came out last year, Dreams and Premonitions. We have a new one coming out in September, Dreams, Premonitions, and the Unexplainable. And so many thousands and thousands of the dreams that were submitted were dream stories about departed loved ones. And my experience, and I've also, you know, talked to so many other dream experts, the collective opinion is that more often than not, these are actual visitations. And now there's no way to scientifically know that. So we can just, you know, we can be our own guides and trust our own guidance. We kind of know when a dream is symbolic and when it feels so real, like it was an actual visitation. And when we have one of these kind of dreams, and even if it isn't a perfectly satisfying experience, I just got somebody that sent me a dream like this. Their father passed away, and they finally got a dream with their father in it, but he wasn't paying attention to them. And it's like he was wandering around looking at other things. And this guy sent me this dream feeling so bad about this. And my perspective is that any dream that you have about a departed loved one means that there must be so much love between the two of you that it's a sign of love. It's a sign of healing. It's a sign of forgiveness, no matter how you slice it. Sometimes our beloveds on the other side are in different stages of being acclimated to their new surroundings. Some of them, it takes a while. It might take a year or two for them to feel calm enough to be able to actually focus on you. You might tune into them in a dream, or they might tune into you in a dream, but it's like you're both kind of wandering in the dark. You think that you're looking directly at them, and they think they're looking directly at you, but you're kind of not finding each other yet. But don't be worried about this if the dream isn't perfectly, I love you. I'm so sorry that I said those things. You're the best son in the world. I love you too, Dad. You know, if it's not perfectly like that, don't be alarmed. Know that life is long and you'll probably have more dreams. But my suggestion to incubate these kind of dreams so that if you've, you know, if you're having a hard time healing and moving on from somebody that you love that's passed away, you can think about them right before you go to sleep. Maybe get a picture of them, light a candle, and just say a prayer that if the timing works for them, that you are available and you would love to have a connection with them, whatever that may be. So you let go of your attachment to it having to be an exact movie script that you've written, and be open to it maybe being very symbolic. Maybe you'll have a dream of a butterfly or a pair of red shoes or something that reminds you of that person. And consider that whatever you get, it's something that comes from this loving connection. So they're a gift. There's nothing that heals more than one of these dreams to heal that unbelievable loss in a more quick way.
I loved it. I loved everything you said. And I love the fact that you said, you know, it's up to the person to gauge their level of connectivity by how they feel. Do they feel? I talk to people here and there and they'll say, you know, my deceased father or my deceased loved one, whoever it may be, came to me last night. And I'll say, congratulations, you made contact. No, but you don't understand. It just seems so real. I'll say, well, congratulations, you made contact. They're right. In this disbelief automatically right. that they're actually right. making such contact.
Right. And they should, I mean, if I could wave my magic wand, these people wouldn't be in disbelief. They would be so, they would feel so deeply loved and they would feel like the person went all the way. Do you know how hard it is to connect from the other side? That is not easy. And us humans here on this side of the veil can be so dense. It takes so much love and so much focus to actually show up in someone's dream. So, I mean, I have a great dream story about somebody that did this. Can I share this with you?
Oh, please. So, yes, absolutely.
A friend of mine, Barbara, she lost her father years ago, and he was the closest person in the world to her. So his passing was beyond devastating to her. And coupled with the fact that she was an absolute atheist, she was a scientist, and so was her father. And she only believed in that which you could see, measure, and quantify. So the moment her father died, in her mind, he was just gone. There was nothing left. So she was totally depressed. And it's years after he passed away. And she has a dream that she remembers. And she doesn't remember ever remembering dreams. This is like a fluke. And in her dream, she's from England. She is back in England in the dream, in her childhood home, and there's a knock at the door in this beautiful English cottage that she lived in, and it's her father. And he looks so young and handsome and fit, and he's glowing. And she bursts into tears and says, "Oh my God, Dad, I missed you so much." Her father, she probably called him father. She was very proper and British. And she just said, "Where have you been? I've missed you so much. This has been so hard without you. Come in, come in, come in." And he said, "No, I can't cross this threshold. This is as far as I can come. But I've been trying so hard to reach you to tell you, you've got to snap out of it.
Thank you.
Stop being so depressed. I am with you. I'm watching you, whether you can see me or hear me or not. I am absolutely with you. So you've got to stop this." And she was like, but. He said, "No more buts. We're done. You can't do this anymore. Not for one more second." So she wakes up from this dream, and it completely busts her entire ego identity, because this meant that maybe that her father was still alive on some level, on another plane, perhaps. So she literally quit her job. She got in a car, went on a road trip, went to Sedona, Arizona, of all places, and, wow. and met some chakra healing people. I don't know. She met all kinds of healers, and she suddenly began to channel. And now this is a very spiritual woman whose entire life changed on a dime because of that dream and her absolute conviction that that wasn't just a metaphoric dream at all. It was very literal. And her father literally came to her to snap her out of her deep, deep depression that might have on its own accord not ever gone away.
That is just truly phenomenal. Phenomenal. Yeah, I work with people a lot, and I tell them, you know, I understand you're not letting go is beautiful. It means to you how much it means to you about right. your passion and your love for the one who's crossed over. Right. But your letting go doesn't mean you don't care.
Right.
It means you're letting go of the fact that they're invisible now. And when you do such things, they're getting to you in the sleep realm is so much easier. It's all the guilt, all that stuff. That's dense stuff. I mean, how do you be on the other side? I mean, how do you they won't violate your free will, but how would they ever begin to bore a hole, to use an expression,
yeah.
to get to you, to say hello, to tell you that I am okay, but also to let you know this is what it's going to be like when it's your turn to cross.
Exactly. Well, all I know is I had a 10 or 15 minute death experience on the other side, not in my body, and trying so hard to communicate with my husband and my beloveds on this side so that they knew for sure I was good and I was okay. I was more than good. I was ecstatic. And there was no way of reaching them. The brick wall was so thick. It was so frustrating. I'm like, oh my God, I've got good news to tell you guys. Life keeps going. It's beautiful. It's awesome. And their grief was a brick wall that was impenetrable. So I know from a little experience of my own how hard it is to break through. And really, it takes that person being able to be asleep because they're more of a captive audience. Their ego is less in the way. And but it takes a tremendous amount of love to finally get through to these people. And it doesn't, and as you said, it's not about letting go of your love for them and, right, and feeling like if you move on and stop grieving that you're somehow betraying them or betraying the love of them. Yeah, that is the tricky part. I mean, I would dare to assert that most long-term grief, if you lose somebody, you're going to have grief. There's no getting around that. But the long-term grief is somehow like a... it's like this love song to that person that you love saying, I can't live if living is without you. So I'm just going to suffer. I'm going to keep on living here, but I'm not going to have any light, no fun. And that should mean I love you. But no, there's another way to love people. There's another way, because on the other side, just from even my experience being on the other side for a few minutes, what I wanted to see was my loved ones not saying, yay, she's gone, woohoo, she's dead, let's party. Not like that. But I wanted to see them saying, oh my God, I get that she's good. I get that she's fine. I wanted to see them smiling. I wanted to see them happy. I wanted to see them somehow being able to tune into me from where I was. And they would have to find me. They would have to elevate their consciousness to find me on the other side. And we have to elevate ourselves. It's kind of like listening to the radio. There's some denser channels that might be easier to find, but there's some of those higher channels and higher frequencies that we have to look for, and they don't come as easily. We have to work at that muscle. And then when we find it, then we can communicate with them. And I think our loved ones on the other side are so happy about that. So it's not just let them go and move on entirely. It might mean let go of the frequency at which you're connecting with them. Ooh, and that you're
that
used
was
to connect.
Really good. Let go of the frequency. And it also provides a bridge. So you can have, yes, an ongoing dialogue. Let me ask, yeah, you this, Kelly. Since, yeah, your life is consumed by dreams,
yeah,
or your dreams, do they consume you when you, mm-hmm, sleep? And I'm sure the answer, I'm assuming, is yes. And so I'm guessing that your life here, being involved with dreams to the level that you play in that arena, but I'm sure these two experiences for you are starting to crossfade to where there is no there in here, because now you're amalgamating both consciousnesses into your open-eyed, but also as you close-eyed experience. Yes?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Ooh, that's good. That's good.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. I mean, we don't have to go anywhere. I mean, heaven isn't a location that's outside of where we are, and hell isn't a location outside of where we are. We can dip in and out of whichever realm we want to based on our thoughts and based on our interests. There's a woman that keeps contacting me with her really funky, funky dreams. And I'm somebody who's not shy. I don't shy away from any dark dream because I can see the beauty in all of them. However, some people don't want to heal. Some people are so fascinated by the darkness. They're so riveted by it that they stay in it much longer than is necessary. And I'm not interested in working with those people. If somebody has a funky dream and they have a sincere desire to heal and be elevated by it and to find the gold in it, then I am the person to work with. But if you're someone that's just having a series of funky dreams and you are more fascinated by that than in your own healing, then call somebody else because we can choose, and I can choose, you know. So really, it's a matter of where we focus our attention, and like a laser beam, we really, like you said, bore a hole through that frequency, through that place. If we focus enough on what does it mean to be the center of light, to be in our own center of light and to grow that light?
I like that.
Then we will discover that. And it doesn't mean run away from the shadows. If they come up, then let's heal them when they come up. Let's not suppress anything, but let's be interested in at least this is what my fascination is. How do I turn anything that comes my way as much as I possibly can into something beautiful, into something light? How can I find the gift in it? I wanted to dip back for one second, if I may.
Sure.
This is about what we were talking about earlier about loved ones coming through. And there was a client of mine whose son died. He was a 27-year-old young man who died. And my client was the mother of the son. And this was, as you can imagine, unbelievably devastating to her and her whole family. And I ended up doing some sessions with each member of the family. And the night after I talked to the father of the young man that passed away, I had unbelievable dreams in the middle of the night where I felt like Brian, the young man who passed away, was giving me a message for his dad. And woke up in the middle of the night and wrote about 5 pages, longhand, stream of consciousness, like, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to sleep unless I get this message out. So here we go. And the basic gist of it was, if you let go of your grief, that doesn't mean you're letting go of your love for me. It means you're like, be my dad on a higher level. Meet me in another place. I don't need you as my father in the same place that you're used to being my father. You were a great dad. You did your job, but I still need you. But I need you to meet me here in this new place so we can have a new relationship. And it's a relationship that will serve me and it will serve you. But the ball is in your court, Dad, because I can only lower my vibration so much. I can't lower it so deep that it's going to meet you in the bottom of your grief. You have to go up to a higher place, and that's where you'll meet me, and we can have a new relationship, and we can still be in each other's lives. In fact, more so and better than we ever have before. And I mean, there's a lot more that came through, but that was the basic gist. And I had never thought about the fact that we can keep having these long-term relationships on the other side with people on the other side before I had that very, very loud and vivid dream.
Wow, that was just very, very delicious. What is the difference between dreaming out-of-body experiences and or what is the difference between those two and lucid dreaming?
Let's see. I don't know if I have the exact perfect science here, but I'll tell you from my experience. I'll just go from my experience. I feel like I'm the authority of my experience.
Dig it.
I feel like they're absolutely related. I mean, from the perspective that we are multi-dimensional beings, we're actually infinitely dimensional beings. And one point of view is the game in life is to access as much of that as possible while still maintaining this three-dimensional form. While being human, can we behold as many layers of ourselves, as many aspects of the mosaic of ourselves while maintaining our connection here without having to float away and die? We don't have to die in order to access the largesse of who we are and what we're capable of. So when we have an out-of-body experience, we get a distinct knowing that we are not just our bodies. And we all know that. That's metaphysics 101. But when you actually have that experience, you know it to the core of your being.
Oh, yeah.
Here I am. I am still me, and my body is over there. Oh my God.
You know what, Kelly? That's one of the things that happens to me every time I have an out-of-body experience or a lucid experience. And to me, dreams are ways of kind of tapping into the field. Out-of-body experiences to travel around and have a little bit of fun. And lucid dreaming is more of a cosmic thing. But I can promise you that one of the things that will crop up when you get good at this, a way to identify that you are in an alternate reality, is one of the first things that will come up is, oh, wow, I am here and I have a body somewhere laying on a bed.
Right. Right. It's, and then you start referring to your body in the third person, like it, those legs, those right. arms, that, and it, and then it becomes precious. Like, oh, that's so cute. It's oh my cute. Goodness. Look what, look at this vehicle. It's like, look at this car I get to drive while I'm here. Look at this body. I need to appreciate that thing. It's so great. But my God, that is not who I am. I mean, my, I wrote a little story after my near death experience. I called it the teacup and the sky. I felt like who I became when I left my body was I became as big as the sky. I became connected to all of life, all of love, all of the wisdom that's ever been. It was all that I was, and I was in it, and I, yet I still had a sense of my own beingness within that, but the expansiveness was infinite. It had no end. And when it was time to come back into my body, which took a tremendous amount of will, and that's the danger, because sometimes we can leave our bodies and we're not always guaranteed that we get to come back, or that we get to come back basically the same. Sometimes this is where there can be, there's a price to pay sometimes for leaving the body. Sometimes people don't come back in the same way, or they're missing something. I mean, I know there's walk-ins happen. There's a friend of mine, and sometimes the walk-in is great and it actually benefits you, and sometimes it's not so great. So it's a little risky business. So you want to make sure you, if you're going to do this deliberately, that you just surround yourself, you put yourself in the center of light. You put light at the center of you, and you are at the center of light, so that if anything does come in, it's something that's going to be good for you. But I know that when it was time for me to come back and condense myself and get back into my body, I didn't really want to. I was fighting with myself on it, but it felt like it was what I needed to do. And I had the choice. I could have just kept on going, and that would have been maybe more joyous, but I decided it was codependence probably that kept me coming back, because I didn't want all the people that I love to grieve and mourn when I was off having so much fun. But I felt like I had to shrink myself and force myself into the size of a little teeny teacup. It's like those cartoons where you see somebody on a big diving board and they look down way, way, way at the world below them, and it's like the size of a little thimble, and they're like going to dive and fit their whole bodies inside of that. It was like that. But once I landed back in my body, this was the most profound time that I left my body and came back. It felt like suddenly so dense and so heavy and so small, but it's been my challenge to be in this body and be in this life and be in all the things of this world while maintaining as much as possible, like you said, Keith, about the bridge to this whole other universe of light, love, wisdom, to be able to be on that bridge as often as possible and carry that back and forth is really the opportunity and the blessing that we get, whether through lucid dreaming or through out-of-body experiences or through regular dreaming.
And exploring these different dimensions of the inner self, when successful, yeah, and over a period of time, every time a person has these kinds of experiences, it begins to alleviate one's fear of death, because there's no longer that separation wall between I'm here and when I die, I'm going to be there. It kind of amalgamates, it crossfades the two. And I had an experience some years ago, quite a few years ago, that described exactly what you said, that you may not come back the same, because I went through a wormhole. They do exist, or at least in my mind and in my experience it did. And when I came through the other side, I was standing before the, what, at least at my level of awareness at the time, what I would consider the Godhead. And there were all these beings in there, and they were dancing. I mean, they were primal dance. I can't explain it any other way. They were dancing. They were having a party. And the word party is the exact word. And they raised the curtain, and they gave me a glimpse. And they said, are you coming in? And the only reason I found a separation between myself and the Godhead is my thought that I had that that's the Godhead. So that created the wall. Mm. And they invited me in, and I knew if I stepped into that place, I wasn't going to come back. And I didn't mean not necessarily physically. That would have been possible. But I knew that everything I believed in, rights, wrongs, goods, bads, ups, downs, positive, negatives, holy, blasphemous, all that was going to be shattered. In some degree, Keith would have died, and I wasn't quite ready for that.
Right.
So I chose not to go in. We actually only have a few minutes left. Quick question on sleep paralysis. Is that a field that you know much about?
I know a tiny bit about it. So I'm not an expert in that, but I, my experience in talking with people, and I've had it a little bit myself. I know that some might say that it's a neurological thing that they should check out. It's a disorder, but I think it also is a phenomenon among people that have naturally very thin walls, and they do go very, very deep. They tend to be somnambulists, people that are highly, they could be, you know, highly suggestible in terms of being able to be open to phenomena, whether good or bad. So they just have to kind of protect themselves. But sleep paralysis is actually not a bad thing. I mean, it's something that we all have. The part of our brain that conducts our motor skills and all of that, it's asleep along with our prefrontal yes. cortex when we're asleep. So we need to be in some form of sleep paralysis. But the issue that happens is that some people sort of wake up, right? And you kind of wake up and you realize, oh, I want to wake up now, but your body doesn't move. And that can yeah. be tremendously terrifying. But I would say, from my perspective, anything that is, if it's a regular phenomenon, you can use that as a prompt toward lucid dreaming if you want. You can know, okay, I must be dreaming because I'm still sleeping. I'm still here. So let me see, instead of trying to fight the river, my body doesn't want to move yet, and that's okay. Let me wrap myself in light. Let me bring in an archangel so I feel protected and I feel okay. And if I'm dreaming and I'm in this in-between state, the tremendous opportunity that's here is to go completely lucid and to explore the universe and to ask the Godhead, what do I need to know? What's important for me to know here? So anything that can be terrifying could, while you're in a dream sleep state, can also be a prompt to let you know I'm dreaming. Now let me do something really useful with
this. Dig that. Kelly, we're at the top of the hour. We have 2 minutes. Actually, would you leave us with a final thought?
Oh, yes. I want people to know that we're always dreaming and that we're co-directing our lives with our creator, whatever you call it, whatever you want to call it. And you can have a dream that is as heavenly as you want it to be based on your attention and your focus and your willingness to get creative. And I hope that everyone listening can just take a big, deep breath right now and just feel that the whole universe, and I mean all of it, is on your side. There's nothing against you. Everything is for you. Let your dreams be a vehicle for you to wake up. Please don't take them lying down. Please know that they are providing you with serious gold about yourself and about your life and about how to be the best possible human being, have a spiritual being having a human experience that you could possibly have.
Kelly, thank you for being a very empowering, even for me, on Center of Light Radio. And please keep us posted about what's going on with you, girl.
My deep, deep honor, deep pleasure. Thank you so much, Keith.
Love
Anthony
and light.
Blanchard, love and light.
Sleep keep in touch and keep us posted about all this amazing success you're doing, reaching millions of people. Keep it up.
Thank you, Keith. Bye.
Everyone, Kelly Sullivan Walden. You can reach at kellysullivanwalden.com. Next week on Center of Light Radio, my guest is Kak Young. We'd be speaking about everything essential oils for those out there who are into that kind of thing. I love the field myself. In fact, I'm going to get me a diffuser real soon, so you can bet after I get empowered by my guests, I'm going to go drop some coinage on some essential oils. I look forward to seeing you next week. Remember, when you lay down at night, breathe, breathe, breathe your way through the ceiling of thought, and you will find yourself in that mystical realm that Kelly and I have been talking about all night. And next thing you know, you will be returning home before you pass away. Peace, love, and light to you. See you soon.